How is everybody out there in virtual land? My name is Randy Johnson, and I'm standing on the lower level piazza, or sitting. Just checking to make sure you're paying attention. Sitting here on the piazza at 18 Anson Street, which is the headquarters for Bulldog Tours. This is where the majority of our tours originate. And as we begin to reopen, which is going to occur very soon, we hope everyone's anxious to come down to Charleston and take a tour with us. We're not sure of the exact date, and those details will be forthcoming. And you'll hear more from John Laverne, the owner of Bulldog Tours, who will give you the details. We are excited, and we are very anxious. We're all jonesing to give tours. And these have been a lifeblood for us because they've given us a chance to stay connected with you, our customers, our fans, people who share the same love for the history of this city that we do. And one thing I want to point out is that getting here to date was an ordeal. As you may have heard, Charleston has an expression, come hell or high water. Well, we had a little bit of both today. Joy and I almost didn't make it down here in time. I was going to have to start my tour on the road in the car, surrounded by about a foot of water. Luckily, low tide isn't that far behind us. High tide's coming up around 6, so we're okay. A lot of the water is flooding out into the drains and into Colonial Lake and other lakes around. And some streets, though, are impassable. And we've already seen a lot of people stalled and calling for help. So welcome to Charleston. And we love it. That's what makes us who we are. And there is an expression here in Charleston. It comes from the state, actually. The motto of South Carolina is Dum Spiro Spero. And it's Latin. And what it means is, while we breathe, we hope. Or while I breathe, I hope. And we are breathing. So we've gotten through this so far. Gotta worry about the water though, because once that water gets over your head, you can't breathe no more. But we're okay right now. And I wanna point out something really interesting you might find a kind of a curiosity, is this contraption right here. Now, it's at 18 Anson Street. That is unusual. That wheelchair is famous and used to sit on the landing at the third floor of the old city jail. But the jail is going through renovations and we had to remove all of the artifacts and other things connected to the jail for safekeeping until we're able to get back in that wonderful building. So Joy and I have the honor of taking it to our home because we can't have it here when tours start. But we're gonna take good care of it, we promise. We're gonna sage it a lot. Do a little greet, some hoodoo, just to make sure we don't bring any of those evil spirits from the jail to our own house. Now, there are only a few more of these. This may be one of the last virtual tours until once we get started back on regular tours, but we wanna thank everybody who supported us, and we probably will be doing some modified version of this as time goes on, so we'll keep you posted on that too. And what I want to talk about today, it's a very general discussion. It's already come up multiple times on many of the other virtual tours. And that is that Charleston has a vein of violence running through its body politic. It always has. I think it has a lot to do with the fact that when you arrived here from England or whatever other part of the world you were coming from, fleeing persecution, seeking your fortune, when you arrived here in this city in the early years, beginning in 1680, it was a rough town. I mean, there was a level of sophistication here generated by the wealth on the backs of the enslaved. And so there was a hierarchy, and there was a group of wealthy people who definitely had it made, living the life of Riley, living high on the hog, as we say here. And it was, but overall, it was a very lawless town in the beginning. And as time went on, it became more crystallized and calcified to the point where by the turn of the century in the early 1800s, Charleston society, Charleston culture had kind of gelled and coalesced into that romantic version of the South that, whether you buy into it or not, prevails as a stereotype of the South and of Charleston in particular, since she was regarded by many as the cultural capital of the Confederacy. Now, someone said something I thought that struck me as very insightful. It was a British commander during the Revolutionary War. complaining about the rowdy people in Charleston and the fact that they were giving him a hard time. And he said something that I think kind of encapsulates what I've been talking about. This British commander said that Charlestown, as it was known back then, is the fountainhead from which all violence flows. Now, Charlestonians would take that as a badge of honor. But here's the interesting part. Over time, Charleston became, in a way, the American capital for dueling. Now, what is dueling? Especially young people often don't know what that term means. Dueling means that two grown men, otherwise seemingly mature and in control of their senses and their faculties, agree with each other on an appointed day to meet in a remote place with two flintlock pistols and shoot at each other, trying to kill the other. Now, that doesn't sound civilized, but in a sense, in an ironic sense, it was, because dueling became for Charlestonians a way to settle their grievances between each other. And mind you, this only applied to the elite. Commoners were not expected, nor encouraged, nor even really permitted to engage in duels. This was a gentleman's blood sport. And it began in Europe. It is medieval. Its origins are deep in European history. But up until the 1700s, it more or less was only performed with swords, sometimes with axes. I mean, duelers could choose their weapon. And but it was always a blade of some kind. And so what that did was kind of reduce the likelihood that you might kill somebody. Didn't take it away, of course. People died in those kinds of duels as well. But the form of injury you could inflict on somebody, in some sense, was less severe, and certainly less direct and quick, as pistols would later do. And this practice extended to the British, extended to the British Army, and made its way over to Charleston in the age of settlement and colonization. But it morphed here. And by 1800, it was an established way for gentlemen in this city to settle their grievances. And what really turned the tide was, again, in the beginning they used first blades, then by 1800 they were only using pistols. And this was an American thing. Let's put all that formality aside, because being a sword fighter required a great deal of training. And most Americans could not avail themselves of training with a sword. So they preferred the pistol, because it kind of evened the playing field. Two people could shoot at each other, and they would both kind of be on the same footing. Of course, taking into account their prowess with a gun and their ability to aim. Charlestonians then very quickly, around the time of the Revolutionary War, switched to flintlock pistols. And flintlock pistols were not weapons you would necessarily choose if you were really out to kill somebody, but back in that day, it was a lethal weapon, could definitely be a lethal weapon. It used a flintlock ignition system. I'm not a gun person, and I apologize if I misstate any of these terms. But it relied upon a flint to ignite a small little piece of powder, but then it set off another explosion that propelled a bullet through a chamber and out into the world. And for the most part, Charlestonians preferred smoothbore pistols, meaning that they were not as accurate as they could be. And one of the ways that Charlestonians would cheat with flintlock pistols, and later with cap percussion, they would rifle, I think is the term, the chamber, and they would put grooves through it that would direct it, and so it would cause the pistol to be much more accurate. And Charlestonians generally frowned upon that, but if they agreed to use one of these more accurate pistols, they were allowed to do so. And what really changed things was around 1820, these percussion cap pistols came into preference and fashion, and many Charleston gentlemen actually had shops here in the city belonging to gunsmiths, and they would take their flintlock pistols to these craftsmen to have them adapted so that they would have a percussion cap as well, so that they could keep their family heirlooms and still use them with modern technology. If you're interested in this subject, there is a collection of these pistols over at the Charleston Museum. And before I go any further, I want to give a big shout out to a person I've become a big fan of. His name is Graham Long, and Graham Long is an amazing writer, and there are many, many books on this subject, but the one I want to recommend to anybody watching who's interested in delving into this subject much more deeply, just get a copy of this book. It's by Graham Long, and it's Refined in the Holy City. Highly recommend. And Mr. Long works over at the museum and is actually one of the curators who's in charge of taking care of those pistols, which appear in these elaborately carved, beautiful. Now, before I get into more detail about duels, let me just say this. What was the legal approach to duels? Were they legal? Dueling was a gentleman's blood sport. And what that meant was that they cherished their honor, and it's chivalric. It comes back from the medieval times. And I know modern minds don't really put much emphasis on honor. I think we all consider ourselves honorable people, but we don't necessarily grab a gun the first time somebody throws an insult at us. But back in the days of Charleston, up until 1880, and I'll get to that, when the last duel was fought in the state, at least the last fatal duel, Charlestonians very much prized their honor. And what would trigger an insult? Well, saying something untoward about one's wife or daughter or mother or fiance. You could definitely insult somebody and trigger a duel challenge if you lied or if you cheated at cards and someone called you on it. And there was a term called, let me get my glasses, something along the lines of taking the lie. And what that meant was that you were being accused of lying and are being dishonorable. You had two choices if you were challenged. One was to agree to the duel, or you could apologize. And apologies were definitely a common thing. Most Charlestonians prided themselves on their civility. These high-end Southern, of course, keeping in mind that all these men were slaveholders, but back in the day they were regarded as gentlemen, and they would do anything they could to avoid a duel. So people think, oh, it was just an instantaneous thing. It was not. There was a code called the Code Duello that originated in Great Britain, however, or in Ireland. The key code, the rules for dueling in South Carolina, were encapsulated in a publication by a man named John Lyle Wilson in 1838, South Carolina, in the rest of the South. He was obviously, John Lyle Wilson was himself, he was a former governor of South Carolina. He was a man who himself had been involved in multiple duels. And let me tell you what that meant, being involved in a duel. There was a cast of characters. First of all, there was the challenger and there was the recipient of the challenge. The two parties who would eventually, if things went badly, wind up standing across from each other several paces away and shooting and trying to kill each other. But before that happened, a lot of things had to take place. There had to be a formal challenge, and before that happened, each of these parties would retain someone of equal social status called a second. And seconds were probably more important to the dueling process than the duelers themselves, because a good second, your assistant, so to speak, would negotiate with the second for the other party and go out of their way, if they were good seconds, to try to ease tensions and resolve the matter as gentlemen and walk away feeling like they both had been vindicated. If that didn't work, then the seconds agreed upon the terms and they could take their time. Many seconds were artful at stretching out the negotiation process to the point where the two parties forgot what they were going to duel about, and that would avoid conflict. But if they had to duel, the seconds would choose the weapons, they would choose the arrangement of the parties, how far they were to be apart, and what weapons were to be used, and then they would also agree upon who would call, who would announce the beginning of the duel, and who would call the end of it. And seconds were incredibly important. And a bad second, of course, as you can see, couldn't protect you. In fact, seconds, if they were not able to negotiate the terms of the duel, often got in duels themselves over the negotiations. So these things could spiral and spread out and involve much more people. But let's say they do eventually get around to the duel. They did not duel in town. There's a famous ghost story we love to tell about the ghost of a man who was killed in a duel in 1786 in an alley nearby. And the story is beautiful, and there is a ghost there who haunts it, who whistles. And that very well could be the same man involved in a duel in 1786, but it's actually quite unlikely. I'm not saying it didn't happen, but it's fairly unlikely it occurred in the city. Duelers did not like to do anything in public. They liked to keep it secret. And most of the time, a common place to duel was to get in a little John boat and go across the harbor to James Island and go to Fort Johnson at the tip near Fort Sumter. And of course, it wasn't built then. And that was it was a remote beach, not too difficult to get to, but kept anybody from following them to watch. A lot of times people dueled up at the race course, which is now Hampton Park. That was a very popular place to duel. And sometimes it's conceivable people could have found a remote area here west of the city that had not been developed yet, that was marshy and beachy, where they might duel. And when they showed up at the appointed time, it could be the morning, afternoon, there was no set time, they would pull their weapons and they would do the number of paces, you know, back to back. Sometimes they didn't bother doing that. The seconds would simply place them where they needed to be. And sometimes they were very close. Sometimes they could be as close as 3 paces, you know, within easy shooting distance to deliver a lethal blow. But often they were much farther apart. And there are even instances of people using shotguns. And of course, at that point, they would have been farther apart. Anyway, if they did not follow the rules at that point, a lot of weird things could happen. And one that I found most intriguing was, what if someone cheated? And there were different ways to cheat. You could use coal-impacted balls to substitute for the real lead balls and share that with your co-dueler. And of course, it would not kill, but you would have a gun with a real lead bullet in it. Obviously not a gentlemanly thing, but it did happen. Sometimes people would disguise the pistols so that when another second would look down to confirm that it was a smooth bore, it would conceal the ridges from the rifling. And that would be, of course, handed to that second's principal so that he would have an advantage where he could aim better. People would wear clothes. This was actually considered okay. You could wear heavy clothes, thick capes and things to make it more difficult to figure out where the body was and all that clothing. Sometimes people wore glasses, what we would call sunglasses, called dueling glasses. You know, I always imagine Johnny Depp wearing them. But they were very thin. They weren't like wide sunglasses. They were like this. And they were focused so that, first of all, it would eliminate glare, especially in fog or on the beach in the bright daylight. But, you know, if two parties agreed to it, they could use those as well. But if one party tried to use it, it often resulted in a delay of the duel as they negotiated whether that would be permissible. And again, you see what would happen. Easing the tension, diffusing the tension to actually avoid conflict. So anyway, was it legal? In the beginning, it was not. But around 1812, the South Carolina legislature realized that this was probably not a good practice in a civilized society. New England had already outlawed it long ago and had eliminated it. In fact, certain statesmen, I think Ben Franklin was once asked what he thought of dueling, and he quickly responded, "Dueling is stupid and resolves nothing." And New Englanders punished duelers. They would, there was one punishment in Massachusetts. If two men were caught in a duel, they could put a noose around your neck, parade you through town, and hook you up to a gallows and let you stand there for an hour. They wouldn't hang you, but they would discourage you. And oftentimes they would also too, if someone was killed in a duel up in New England, they would divert that corpse to a surgeon who would use it for dissection and research, which back then was an anathema for religious reasons. People did not want the bodies of their loved ones being dissected. But what about Charleston? Nobody really cared. And in the 1812, the legislature tried to outlaw it. It was a weak statute. It never took effect. Nobody really paid attention to it. And when people got into duels, if somebody got murdered, they would simply, if a prosecutor even bothered to try them, they would wind up getting an acquittal. And so this continued through the Civil War. But finally, after the Civil War, things changed. The elite here was flipped on its head. The entire social structure of the city was changed, and this idea of honor and gentlemen began to fade away, but it still persisted among former Confederates. And the last fatal duel in South Carolina occurred somewhere near Bishopville, not far from Charleston, between a man named Mr. Cash and a man named Mr. Shannon. Now, I could spend days giving you the details of the duel between these two men, what we would consider frivolous, but it basically boiled down to a dispute involving a woman. And who died as a result of stress imposed by property litigation between the two parties. So it had really nothing to do with the common things we think of as for a duel. And these two men wound up attracting a crowd of 100 people. Normally they tried to keep crowds away, but they couldn't keep them away from this one. And the two men shot at each other. What was really sad was is that Mr. Shannon was a very elderly man, and Cash was fairly young, and so it wasn't really an even match. And Shannon went down, and Cash was arrested. He was tried for murder twice in Darlington, South Carolina. The first jury was hung, and he was subjected to a second trial at which he was acquitted. So he got away with it. But that generated a lot of public sentiment against dueling in South Carolina. And with the help of a very famous Charlestonian, a British-born man who was the editor of the local paper, the Post and Courier, Frank Dawson, there was a campaign against it, and eventually there was a law, I think it was in 1880, right after the Cash-Shannon duel, that outlawed dueling for good. And not only did it outlaw dueling, it even outlawed the procedure between seconds. So if anyone engaged in a duel as a second, and if you committed murder, you would be tried for a special kind of murder. That pretty much put an end to the practice here. However, it is ironic that in 2006, just a few years ago, Charleston Police Department actually brought charges against a man who killed another man in a duel up near Cannon and Spring Street, Cannon and King, and was convicted, I think, of dueling, killing a man in a duel. So it still happens. And of course, what does it mean? What is dueling? It's two men standing up and shooting at each other to settle their disputes. And what happened at this duel up in 2006 was that two men just got in a fight, started arguing with each other, it escalated. One of them said, "Go get your gun." And so the other man ran and got his gun, and they duked it out and shot at each other in the street, and one of them wound up dead. So it still happens, but it's extremely rare. So anyway, I'm gonna wrap this up. Sorry if I took too long, but I just wanna share this with you. If you're interested in the code that outlaws dueling in South Carolina, it's section 16-3-410 of the South Carolina Code. And I just want to mention two other things, and then we'll wrap it up. One, what could a dueler avoid the duel and end it by wasting his shot? Heavily frowned upon in the Code Duello. But John Lyle Wilson's Code of Honor didn't say anything about it. And so it's called deloping, where you point your gun down or point your gun up and shoot. Basically, as far as John Lyle Wilson was concerned, it was not a dishonorable thing to do. So men did do it in South Carolina as a way of showing compassion and kind of admitting that this is silly and let's wrap it up and go home. Now, there are two expressions that come out of dueling I found really intriguing. One was, "I have a meeting with the Iron Man." What does that mean? Well, in Charleston, if you aggravated another man and he took offense, rather than challenge the other to a duel right there on the spot, he could simply look him in the eyes and say, I'll deal with you later. Right now, I have a meeting with the Iron Man. Now, what did that mean? When men practiced for duels, they would construct these iron two-dimensional figures as tall as a real man, set it up in a field, and shoot at it. So when a man told you that he had a meeting with an Iron Man, what he meant was, you don't shape up. We're going to be in a duel, and I'm going right now to practice. And the other thing I found kind of sweet was that on a set of dueling pistols used in this period, on the box there's a quotation, and it says, pistols for two, because there would have been two twin pistols in the box. Pistols for two, coffee for one. So anyway, hope you enjoyed it. I could talk about this subject forever. I was recently almost drawn into a duel just a few weeks ago, but that's for another tale. And again, I really hope you guys enjoyed this. We love you. Stay with us, and we're going to get through this. Anyway, have a great day, and hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.